Welcome to our worship service at Red Rock Christian Church. We are glad that you are here on World Communion Sunday. This is a special day when in different time zones throughout the day around the world, different traditions, people are gathering around the Lord's table in many different ways, but symbolizing today that all are welcome into Christ's family, and that we are all one body in each sanctuary, in each worship space, wherever that is, all around the world. We are connected by the love of God and our love for God and for Jesus Christ. So we're glad that you are here. We invite everyone to find the green welcome sheet in your bulletin and fill that out as best you can, and especially those that have been here forever, please fill that out so that you make a good role model for anybody who's new. And you can also use the backside for prayer requests and for any communications with the church office. We do look at your announcement sheet when you get a chance, the prayer requests. And a few things. We're celebrating with Reese this week and with the McCracken family. It's been a long journey, and many of you have been a part of that in some way.
Come on down.
Yeah, there's going to be a party for good reason. And Kara is here. Yay. And I'm supposed to, though, she can close her ears, but I was told this morning that there's three more dinners that could be filled in the next week or so. So if anybody else, if you saw that we've been trying to arrange some meals to help out the Sousa family, because they've helped us so much over the years. And I hope you're excited about our stewardship campaign, because we're talking about the church, just like World Communion Sunday. This is the presence that we can have. What we do in our stewardship campaign is talk about our future, of how we continue to be a place of hope and encouragement and sharing the good news. And if that doesn't excite you enough, there's going to be pie in between services next week. So come early if you come to this service, and come enjoy some just joy. And I think that's all I need to mention there. We have special guests today, the folks from the POC, the Pacific Outreach Christian Church. They're going to be singing a song for us as a part of our World Communion celebration. And I appreciate Kay arranging our table. This is a day to celebrate and a day to come together and worship together, because we have a God that is wonderful and beyond our description and worthy of our worship. So I'm going to move on over, and we're going to start singing some gathering songs as we move along in our worship. And so I invite you to stand as you're able. I didn't mention the reconciliation offering. Please look at that too. And stand as you're able, and let's sing God's praises. Jump right in there.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all, a cup of blessing which we
yeah.
to worship every Sunday morning to celebrate that through Jesus, God came into our world and loved us. We celebrate that Jesus died to show us the unlimited nature of God's love. We celebrate that Jesus was resurrected, showing us that not even death can stop God's loving purposes. So come, let us worship the living and loving God who came and who comes into our lives. Let's continue singing, "Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Our broken and find healing, where we bring our very selves and
I'd like to invite the children to come and help me with the children's time. Come on. And it's food day, so if you have some food, put it in the aisle and children will bring it out. Good morning. Anybody else come? Oh, and if you have money, hold it up in the air and the children will come by and pick it up. And put it in the bucket too. We can buy some food. Thank you guys and gals. Do you remember that we've been talking about the book, The Giving Tree, by Shel Silverstein, the last few weeks? And we have our giving tree up here, where we've got a few warm gloves and hats, and we're inviting people, young people or older people, to bring some warm clothes that we can give to school children that need those to stay warm. Because it's starting to get chilly at night, isn't it? Yeah, and even staying a little chilly during the day. But we'll have one more chance. We can bring stuff next week, because next week is our commitment Sunday. It's a Sunday about giving, where people will bring some things for the giving tree. And we're also, a lot of us are going to bring our estimates of giving, which is how we plan for the funding of our ministries and missions for next year. And so a lot of people are going to sign a little, it's not quite a promise, but it's an estimate of what they think they're going to give to the church so we can plan what we have for funding our ministries. So, I brought something special for today. Let's see if I can find it in my bag. Here it is. Anybody tell me what this is? Kind of confusing, huh? Can you tell me what it looks like? Do you have any thoughts of what it might look like? Yeah. Boy, you nailed that right on. Say it again.
Looks like a globe.
Looks kind of like a globe, right? Yeah. It's not the whole world, though. Anybody else have thoughts?
Yeah. It looks peaceful because of all the mountains and trees and flowers.
Yeah. You can thank Shannon for that. See, it's really a wooden ball that I made, and then I gave it to Shannon, and she painted it up to look really pretty. And it is kind of a globe, but it's just a small portion of our world, because our world's pretty big, isn't it? And even if it had the whole world on it, it'd have to make everything really small, right? But what I was really looking for when I was thinking of what to talk about today was a globe, because this is World Communion Sunday. And this is a Sunday where we remember that this isn't all of God's church. This is where we come and worship, in this sanctuary, but there are people all around the world, and as you know about the time zones, that it's a different time in lots of different places. So some people are still sleeping, but other people have been worshiping and gathering around the Lord's table in worship for hours. And all of them are helping us to symbolize around the world that God's church covers the whole world, and that everybody is welcome, particularly to the Lord's table, where we celebrate communion. Now, to kind of think about how big the world is, have any of you been to another country? You have? Can you tell me where?
I forgot.
Okay, if you think of it, tell me, okay? How about you? Where did you live? People got through? Okay. Anybody? How about this? Do any of you have dreams of someday going to another country? Where would you go first if you got to go to another country?
Paris.
That's in France, right?
California.
That's kind of like another country, right? Okay. Thanks for sharing that.
You go to London?
London in England, the United Kingdom. Anybody else? Anybody? Okay. Well, I was going to share a couple things because I've gotten to go to other countries, and I brought a couple things to kind of share where I've been. One of these is, I thought it was kind of a stool, but it's more like a table runner because it's too wide for a stool. But this I got in Nicaragua when I was visiting Nicaragua. Just a really pretty cloth to help me remember the time that I was there. Do you know where Nicaragua is? It's in Central America, which is south of Mexico. It's in between North America and South America. This is a camel made out of olive wood from Israel. I got to go to Israel when I was finishing up seminary and going into the ministry. And that was a wonderful experience to walk where Jesus walked. And so when I go, when I read the Bible, I have pictures in my mind of the places that are talked about in the Bible. And this was from Israel too. Out behind the museum, they were just throwing pieces away, and I picked one up just thinking that this could be 2,000 years old or older. It might be 3,000. And that's pretty cool to have something that somebody made and used that long ago. So I just wanted to share you those things with you to hopefully help you to get a sense of how big our world is. There's things that are made, there's people that do things differently than us, but all of them are welcome at the Lord's table and in Christ's church. So, see if I look at my notes here. My next thing was to point out, so if it's such a big church, how important is it for each of us to be a part of it? How important are we to the church? How about you guys? Is it important that, are you an important part of the church? Lighten it up. You are, right? What can you do as part of the church that makes a difference in our world? Can you think of anything?
You can be kind to everybody.
Yeah, you can be kind to just here, everywhere, so other people will know about our church.
You can put food in the food pantry.
You can put food in the food pantry, and then that goes to feed hungry people, right? And that goes all around our community.
You could treat others how you want to be treated.
Ooh, that's a good answer. Treat people like you want to be treated. That's called the golden rule. And that's a lot of what Jesus taught us. So each of us can make a difference, right? Yeah. And that's an important part of having so many churches around the world. Can you imagine if everybody in every church around the world did those things that you guys are talking about? How much difference that makes? Yeah?
That would make a huge difference, because then our world would be more caring and nice.
Yeah. And you know what? That is happening all around our world. And it is making a difference. You know, we think that our world has a lot of problems, but there's a lot of good things happening around the world. A lot of people being helped, and a lot of churches that are doing that and making a difference and sharing God's love in lots of ways. So bottom line, no matter how big or small you are, no matter how old you are, just think about, let's imagine a little bit about how much of a difference we can make of showing God's love, hearing voices all around us. And imagine if the whole world, what that difference would make in every church. And it all starts with who? With you? Yeah, good answer. You have that. Each one of us is important, and if each one of us does something to do our part in this church and out in the community to share God's love, it makes a better world. And that's important. So will you guys pray with me? I'll start and you guys repeat after me, okay? Dear God, thank you for a big church full of your people from all over the world. Give us courage to show your love to everyone we meet. And thank you for loving me. Amen. Well, thank you guys. You were a big help today. Bringing the food up and helping me with this. So you can go back to your seats and we'll continue in our worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, I'm not sure if this ever happens to you, but on occasion, okay, maybe I should admit regularly, I'm looking for a missing item that I can't seem to find. And despite my exhaustive search, I can't find it. Then my lovely wife, Cindy, takes a quick glance into one of the many places I have thoroughly searched and immediately finds what I'm looking for. How could I have missed it, I say to myself. It was right in front of my nose. Even though I think I'm paying attention, I'm not seeing everything as it is, but rather I'm seeing through a filter of my own expectations. In much the same way, I believe there are miracles in my life that I do not recognize. Gifts and blessings surround me each day, but I'm often unaware of them, though I claim to be searching for anything that's gone right. It's easier to recognize when others do this. I can clearly see when one of the students at my school receives the wonderful gift of extra support and a helping hand. But they do not really appreciate that an effort, indeed sometimes quite a lot of effort, has gone on behind the scenes just for them. At times, I am able to break through my own situational blindness and see that I'm surrounded by miracles and light and love, and that enormous efforts have been made and are being made on my behalf. As I began in my youth to emerge from the self-imposed blindness of adolescence, I saw clearly, if only for a moment, some of the sacrifices and efforts my parents had made for me. In recognition of this, I wrote my mom a card on her birthday, and I said that I would like to thank her for everything she has done and apologize for everything I've done. She kept that card for many years. Didn't bring it out, but I knew she had it. I think she kept it as evidence that there was hope for me. If you recognize that there are times when you get caught up in life's problems, that you cannot see the blessings that are right in front of you, be a blessing to someone else. If you notice that others are missing the good news in their lives, be the gift that will help them see that there are those who care for them. Help the church be the engine of change, to be the light that shines on the blessings that are right in front of us. By giving, we acknowledge blessings we have received, even if we may not have recognized them at the time. On this day of World Communion, reflect on and clearly see the blessing that is the faith community in this world. and contribute to the work we continue to do as a grateful part of that community. For the deacons. That we may be a better instrument for your work of healing and inclusion in this world. We pray that your peace finds those in turmoil, that your light finds those lost in the darkness, that your word is the key that frees us from our self-imposed prison of isolation, that my love, your love opens the hearts of humanity and brings us together to create a world that works for all. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Please be seated. And before we move into our prayer time, Mr. Greg Anderson has some video. We're going to hear from some of our teenagers.
Yes, you've all been waiting, and I know that's why you're all here this morning, because you wanted to see our celebrities of the day. And they're in the house, so if you need autographs afterwards, please see them. I'm sure this will be entertaining for you. Thank you.
I also sing in choir, and I also do drums and stuff, and then, like, as youth, we can also bring newer people into the church to keep the community growing as the years go on. Just by telling them about the community that we have, and, like, the bonds that we all have together, and that we're all really, really close friends. Yeah, it's worked before, so.
Yeah, I have a couple friends at the moment that are looking for a church, and they told them all about Red Rock and their own community.
Kind of like I said before, just the bonds that I have with a lot of people here and the memories that I've made either through the youth program or church or Sunday school or church camp. I want other kids in the future to have that same opportunity as me.
And for coming to this church every Sunday gives me joy, knowing that God's always with me, even when I'm not at church, and I get to be with friends that I may not see a lot, so I come to church to see them also.
And also, like, it gives me just renewed strength for the week, because I'm usually, so by like Saturday, I'm drained from all the work and stuff, and church can just like a relaxing period to have just a conversation with God and Him like building me up again when He speaks. Yeah, there definitely have been some times, but like the transitions from pastor to pastor, that was kind of a rough period, but like I learned to just grow with change and accept it, and it has opened many doors for me in my faith personally.
Well, everything that Kara Susa has done for the office, and how she puts together the bulletins and the pantries and everything she does for community supper and beyond is just amazing. How she gives her life to so many people.
Kay is probably one of my favorites because she just brings a whole other energy level to church with her music and then some of the things that she teaches us. And then a lot of the elders too, they give really good messages every Sunday that I love to hear from.
Pastor Kevin, because he shows us through his sermons and his speakings how God is always with us, and shows us God.
Yeah, and Pastor Kevin too, because he gets involved with the youth program and with everyone. Well, he like comes to every group. He came to church camp. He was my group leader, and that was a really good experience. He just gets involved, whether it's within music or ministry. I can't, like, just with offering, I see people put in checks and stuff, I'm just like, okay, but it doesn't really, I don't know. I mean, it does mean something to me because it helps keep this church alive in a way, but really it's the people that run the church, it's not about like the money and stuff.
Yeah, like every once in a while I'll see my grandma, Vicky, put in checks into the offering, and but that's every once in a while, and so she won't do it a lot because we don't need money to keep this church going. We need our faith and our people. Observant and common sense.
Yeah, just observant, and then just people guiding us along the way, because we would not be here without the church, honestly.
Yes. Whether we like it or not, there will be. Because youth is our future, and
probably.
I'll bring my kids and my grandkids. No.
We will be the parents now. Yes.
They don't make time. Be yourself, and just let yourself shine through like talents or volunteering or anything you can.
Give the time, I guess, to come. At, like, if you can't come every Sunday, at least once a month, like once every 2 months, just give time to God.
intelligent and very articulate. Huh. No problem with that. We come to our time of prayer, and that's a good place to start off in our prayers, with our praying for our youth and our ministries and other opportunities that we have to share God's love and to shine the light of Christ around and to invite people to come and be a part of this church. You can see in your announcement sheet several prayer requests that have come in the last week. We've added Reese and the McCracken family and the celebration coming up, but continued prayers needed. Our youth, the people of Indonesia that are suffering, and thank goodness the church is a part of that. Our church world services is a part of that, and that's a way that you can make a difference through a week of compassion for our church world services. We keep Karen in our prayers. She's frustrated that she isn't back yet, but she's got to heal, and we're glad that she's able to. Are there any other prayer requests we should lift up this morning? There are a number of things happening in the life of our church that maybe don't go unspoken out loud, but know that you are being prayed for. Let us turn our attention to God fully as we enter into this time of prayer, lifting up these joys and concerns, remembering that this is World Communion Sunday, remembering, as Claire said, that God's with us all the time and listens to our prayers, but also speaks to us. And if we sit still and listen, we might hear a message. And we're always welcome to just sit in God's presence. So let us join in prayer, beginning with a time of silent prayer. Eternal loving God, creator of all, giver of all that is good in this world, we come to worship you and to celebrate your love, to celebrate the good works that you continue to do through us, with us, in spite of us if needed. We thank you for the blessings that you rain down upon us, to the point that sometimes we start feeling entitled and forget that every blessing is a gift, and that we have been gifted way beyond what we deserve. We're grateful, O God, for this church here in this place, the churches around Boise that lift up the message of the good news of your love and of your son Jesus, and churches all around the world that are gathering today to remember what you have done through Jesus, through your actions and your love throughout the centuries, and the hope that we have that your love and your grace and your blessings are eternal, that you will have invited us to be a part of that eternity. We thank you for bringing us together, and we thank you for giving us enough that we can give to others. We remember especially today Reese and the McCracken family, Gabby's dad, Michael, Gertrude, Doris Butler's family, Vicki Godfrey, Willow Clark, and Shannon, her daughter, Sandy Musser's family, and Kevin Anderson's friend, and Connie Nestle. We pray for the ministry of Pacific Outreach Christian Church, and we pray for our relationship with them, that we can support them, and we're grateful for their presence today and this relationship that is growing. And for our other disciple sister churches in Ontario and Parkview and around the world, part of this movement for wholeness in this fragmented world. We lift up the refugees, the poor and the struggling, those who get left out, even in the midst of this prosperous world where you've given enough for everyone. And we lift up our youth, and we lift up Kara and her family, the people of Indonesia, and you know the rest of our concerns, the rest of our prayers. We thank you for being a God who listens, who loves, who walks with us through this life. And we continue to pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
But what really hit me was that, you know, and sing the song you were doing, actually practicing another song, and says, I want to be ready for that long, high road. Well, when I'm talking to my friend Mildred, who's 103, she's so ready for that long, high road, you know? And me, it's not something I think about every day, you know? I've had some really good news, health-wise, and different things like that. I have things I'm involved in. You know, there's always another Bible study to be done, or a song to be sung. But that really made me stop and think, because it happened so fast, I didn't see it. I saw nothing. I didn't see any of it, but a black blur going this way. So I'm very lucky to just have a bent fender, and God was watching out for me. He's not done with me yet. And so when you look at this song we're singing today, with, you know, Jesus paid it all, you know, are we really ready? You know, one of the verses says, for nothing good abide but by thy grace to claim. All these things I love to do, like the Bible study and the singing, that's not what gets me there. But what gets me there is, do I know Jesus? Because he paid it all.
Thank you.
That was beautiful. We continue in worship with sermon and scripture reading coming from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. This is following the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus. And I invite you to look around for your pew Bible and to join with me in reading. I will read the odd number of verses by myself, but I invite you to read with me on the even number of verses. On the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." May God bless our hearing and our understanding of this scripture. Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for these scriptures, for all the stories in the Bible that share your love, share your grace and mercy, and all the ways you have been at work that give us hope for what you are doing now and what you continue to do even into eternity. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I can hardly believe it. He's gone. What do we do now? It's Peter's fault. He should have, just then, a stranger comes up from behind and says, I'm sorry, but I couldn't help overhearing you. Who are you discussing? They stop and turn. Other travelers make their way around them as the three stand in silence. Finally, one of them asks, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days? He asked them, what things? They replied, the things about Jesus of Nazareth, who is a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. We had hoped. Do you hear those words? When was the last time you spoke those words or thought them? Surely we have each felt the emotions behind those words. They are natural human emotions when life does not turn out as we planned, as we hoped for. You see, crucifixion is a universal human experience. We know what those disciples were feeling, lost, wandering back home, plodding along, talking about what ifs, wondering what could have been. Just a few days earlier, they had walked this same road filled with hope and excitement on their pilgrimage to Jerusalem for the Passover feast. They would be seeing Jesus again, their teacher, their friend, prophet, mighty in deed and word. Could he be the one? Could he be the Messiah? We startle awake with the alarm clock ringing. We check for rain or another excuse to roll back over. We straggle in the front door of the church and down the hall, weighed down by worries about family, friends, the economy, politics, stress at work or school. We remember dreaming of much more for ourselves, for our families, for America, for our church. We remember when life was less complicated. We remember the good old days. We had hoped. And we are the people of hope, the ones who come to church. Think about the multitudes that don't come and don't experience the stories, or share in the fellowship, or share in the Lord's Supper. Can you imagine what they say they had hoped for? Can you imagine if this church wasn't here? Or if it isn't healthy and strong for those who are our children's age, our grandchildren's age? Who will help them to find hope? On down that road to Emmaus, Jesus walked with those disciples and listened to their stories of what might have been. They didn't recognize him. When they finished their story, Jesus reminded them of all the scriptures that had told about his death, about the bad things that would happen along the way to his final glory, why these all had to happen. But it wasn't until they stopped for the night, stopped Jesus from going on, invited him to share with them in a meal at the inn. It wasn't until Jesus broke the bread with them that they fully understood. This scene is portrayed by Italian painter Michelangelo da Caravaggio. Caravaggio, as he's known. It portrays the end of that journey, following the pilgrimage to Jerusalem, following all the events that took place there, following their desperate questioning along their return, and following Jesus incognito appearance. We get to look on as Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. Supper at Emmaus is a favorite painting of mine, about 4.5 feet tall by about over six feet wide, presenting the characters almost life-size. As we gaze at the scene, we sense our own proximity, our presence at the table. In fact, we find a space left for us. We share the perspective of the disciple with the green jacket. And so his reaction is also ours, suddenly recognizing Jesus. Holy crow! As a friend of Shannon and I from Sayre would say, we grab our chair to move away, as we are also drawn closer in the mix of fear and awe. The whole painting draws us closer, yet holds us back in that feeling of awe. The chicken, bread, and fruit look delicious, inviting us to come and sit with Jesus, finally revealed in the breaking of that bread just before he disappears from sight. Caravaggio was known for his realism, the ordinariness of his characters. Just look at Jesus' unbearded face, the tear in the green jacket, the joinery in the furniture. One could build a chair from the detail. This is an ordinary moment which is transformed by Jesus' appearance. First, on the road of despair, Jesus walks with them. He listens to their stories, then he reminds them of where their hope comes from. He looks back with them, but then he turns their attention toward the future, to where their hope truly resides. And they respond, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he walked and while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" And they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11, those with them, and those with them, assembled together and saying, "It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. What is it that you had hoped for? What is it that you dreamed of before crucifixion entered your life? Was it your health, your career, your family, depression, your hopes and dreams? How many times have you walked that road to Emmaus? Many people walk that road to a bar instead, or to a movie, or to the mall for a new suit, or a new car, or more cigarettes or candy bars than they really want. Maybe even to a church, anything to make them forget that in this world, even the wisest, purest, most beautiful, even our hopes and dreams about love, justice, and freedom experience crucifixion, decay, and death. Frederick Buechner interprets Emmaus as the place we go in order to escape, where it is we throw up our hands and say, "Let the whole damn thing go hang. It makes no difference anymore." Supper at Emmaus and Luke's narrative of the road to Emmaus both tell us that the risen Lord meets us on the road to our Emmaus, in the ordinary places and experiences of our lives, and in the places to which we retreat when life is too much for us. We are warned, however, that the Lord may come to us in an unfamiliar guise when we least expect Him, and that every meal or act of hospitality along the way has the potential of becoming a sacred occasion. Particularly, every time we gather around this table, the risen Lord is present, walking with us on our road to Emmaus, listening to our hearts, our hurts and disappointments, and reminding us to look back on the promises of old, the scripture story of God's purposes, to bring all things, all people, the whole world, in fact, even you and me, back into life, back into community, back into right relationship, back into God's hopes and dreams for you. Dreams of peace, of justice and mercy for all, of wholeness and of fulfillment in life, of walking humbly with Jesus. And your financial commitments and gifts and talents that you bring to this church, give this church the ability to also walk alongside our neighbors, our grandchildren, the next generation on their journeys to Emmaus, to share the bread and cup with them, to offer hope, to offer wholeness in this fragmented world. Will we offer them that hope? Yes, Jesus invites you to look back, but not to ask what if. Rather, Jesus invites you, us, to look back and be reminded what will be God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Not the kingdoms of power and oppression we see today. And what will be includes Jesus walking every road right beside you into God's kingdom, even into eternity. Will you pray with me? Blessed, loving God, what a joy it is to be reminded that you are with us, even now. You have been with us. We can look back and see that you have been with your people, with all of your people, from the beginning of time. And you have walked with them in good times and bad times, right up to this day. And we know from that tomorrow and the next day, and right up the road to eternity, you are walking with us and loving us and working for good and love in this world, in our lives, bringing that wholeness, bringing life eternal. We thank you, O God, and we respond by giving ourselves to you. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we come to our invitation hymn, we have a special treat this morning in honor of World Communion Sunday. I'd like to invite the POCC folks, if you're ready to come forward and sing.
Before we can sing the song, first of all, we'd like to praise the Lord for this beautiful day that we could be together again. Thank you so much for having us again and for showing us the love of Christ that's in you guys, that you guys showed to us. I would like to say a few words about when I woke up this morning and I read the scripture in the book of Psalm 145. It says, My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Every creature will praise Him. I came to America and I left my mom, my parents, and my best friends. And it's a sad moment that I left them. And I miss them so much. And I arrived in America here in Boise, and my mom called. And the first thing she asked, she said, "Did you touch the snow?" And I was like, "Mom, are you gonna say how was my flight, or how was there, how was everything?" But the thing she said is, "Did you touch the snow?" In everything that we do, we want to praise the Lord for everything that He has done to each and every one of us. The song that we'll sing in English, and also we'll sing in our language. But the song is pretty much, it's a prayer song that we always sing as a prayer for our song.
Did you notice it was beautiful when you were singing it in English, but when you went to your own language, it just filled the room? And it was voices and maybe a little of the Holy Spirit filling this place. And we were symbolizing today that it's one church. We are all one church. And what a wonderful thing to celebrate on this day. And we continue in that celebration with our invitation hymn, which is another reminder. In Christ, there is no east or west. We've seen that. And so it's an invitation time also that if you aren't a part of a local church, if you aren't a part of the church universal, we invite you to come as we sing this invitation hymn, and you can have the opportunity to make that commitment to Christ and to be a part of this church here as we do our part in what God is doing through the church all around the world. So I invite you to stand as you're able and join in singing in Christ that is no east or west. And come to
Church of the Holy Spirit began their worship service by marching through the streets of their village, singing and dancing in order to rally members into the church. In Basel, Switzerland, the Ecumenical Patriarch blessed a new Orthodox church and the community gathered to celebrate Holy Communion. In Seoul, South Korea, the Yodo Full Gospel Church held 7 different worship services today with over 25,000 people in each service. In Turkey, the worship service of Virgin Mary Syriac Orthodox Church included ancient liturgy and the practice of the sacraments. Many of the Christians living there can trace their roots back to the time of Jesus, and a number of them still speak Aramaic. In Seattle, Washington, the Church of Mary Magdalene will share communion this morning as an ecumenical congregation consisting of former and current homeless women. Today we celebrate how God's Spirit is moving and working in vastly different Christians from Africa to Europe, from Asia to the Americas. Even in the midst of all our divisions and disagreements and violence and war, we can draw together to witness the love of God. Come to the Lord's table today, not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you seek God's strength. All who trust Jesus are invited to participate in this celebration of God's love. Please reaffirm your faith with me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, Savior and Lord of my life. Just a short explanation of communion today. We will be coming forward to take the bread and the cup at the front, and then we will form a circle around the sanctuary. Those who cannot come forward, stay in your seats, and the elders will bring communion to you. So would you please pray with me? Gracious God, you have created us in your image, fed us the bread of life, and connected us all to your followers on earth. Forgive us for those times when we have fallen short of your expectations. Renew our commitment to serve you as we partake of these emblems. May this meal strengthen us, your disciples, to engage in peacemaking and sharing your love and reconciliation with all people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus was teaching the disciples to remember what God had done before when he led them out of Egypt, out of slavery to the powers that be. And Jesus showed them in the midst of the meal how they can remember that they are free, that we are free from the powers that be because we are invited into God's kingdom. And he did that by taking a loaf of bread and giving thanks to God. most common thing. He broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then at the end of the celebration, the meal, Jesus poured out a cup and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This cup represents the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." So as often as we share in this bread and this cup at this table, wherever we are, we remember that Jesus gave his life for our forgiveness, for our sins, so that we can have life and that we can always be welcome at this table and always know that God and Jesus are walking with us. All are welcome. Come to the table of our Lord.
Yeah.
as we join hymns around this sanctuary with brothers and sisters in Christ from around the world, we symbolize the churches, the one church, gathered together, held together by God's Spirit all around the world today. As you go today, follow Jesus. Know that He walks with you as you walk toward the cross. Because the way of the cross leads to death, but beyond death. Follow Jesus because He leads you to life, eternal life. Go now knowing that He is always with you every step of the way. May God bless you. Let's sing our closing song, Go My Children.
Christ be with you.
And with you also.
Again, God bless.